You know, there's a concept in Judaism that if you do it the first time, it's a sin. If you do it a second time, it's not such a sin. And if you do it a third time, it's a mitzvah. The idea being that once something becomes commonplace, when you do it often, it suddenly isn't such a big deal anymore. And nowhere could that be more apparent than when it comes to not just masturbation, but pornography. In the era that we live now, it's predominant. You can be a married yeshiva bacher, you can be a modern secular Jew, you can be a young teenager, and we are all challenged with the same thing. The smut and garbage that's on the computer that is alluring. We're men here, we're boys here. A man is married and his wife is no longer interested in him, or he finds himself wandering onto a computer. He's going to eventually come across something that he shouldn't look at. And I had a problem with that, and I was able to end that problem very quickly, and I wanted to tell you how, but I also wanted to tell you why it's so important. It's so important because there are spiritual damages that we do to ourselves and the world around us by spilling seed. Well, it doesn't seem like a big deal. It feels good. It's relaxing. Spiritually, it's very damaging. I can tell you from personal experience that the people that I know who have stopped doing that have helped their marriages. Many people who get divorced, the statistics are saying now close to 40% of people that are getting a divorce, it has something to do with someone looking at pornography, or worse in the marriage. Spiritual damage. You don't know what you're doing when you do that, and God and the rabbis tell you not to do it, so there must be a very good reason for that. I've seen my income increase since I gave that up. These are things that we can all do, and see the actual results of it. Pornography is an interesting thing because when you watch it, you don't think it's such a big deal, but it puts thoughts into your conscious subconscious that cannot bring you to a better place than where you are had you not watched it. And what ends up happening is your body, your psyche, and your sexuality becomes attuned to looking at that, and you become desensitized. So in a sense, it damages you physiologically and physically and mentally, and it could literally damage your life. The way I stopped was, number one, I knew that I was going to make more money based on every Kabbalist I had gone to if I stopped doing that. They knew that I was doing it. And number two, I realized that if I wasn't going to break Shabbos, if I wasn't going to eat pork, then why did I think it was okay to do that? Since I knew that I would never turn on a light, even if he gave me $1 million on Shabbos, that I was never going to eat pork, no way, unless, of course, I was going to die, God forbid. There was no way I was ever going to masturbate again. I was never going to look at a computer. I was never going to look at a dirty thing. I don't have filters on my computer. I am my filter. I do not even consider turning on the computer and looking at that. The second I see a woman who's scantily dressed, I just turn it off and I walk away. It's off limits. It's not allowed. It's like you put it there. Just imagine every time you went to that site, you were going to get AIDS, God forbid. You would never go. You'd be like, I can't do that. You know, if sniffles, I could do that. I can't do it. That's how you have to look at it. Like, God forbid, I don't want to even go there. And I know that's a terrible thing to say, but the truth is, if you look at it that way, you will prevent yourself from doing that. Your marriage will get better. Well, let's say you're not married, you're doing it. Well, I guarantee you, everything in your personal life will get better. Oh, but I have prostate issues, blah, blah, blah. That's okay. You don't have to do that. There are ways around it. So all in all, it's the choice that we have to make. It is a challenge of our generation, but it can be beaten. And in terms of women, if you're a spouse, that's something very available to your husband. You have to be aware. If you're tired or you have a headache all the time or you don't seem to find time to be with him, believe me, there's a computer screen that will find time for him. That, unfortunately, is the reality of the generation we're living in. And you have a choice. You can ignore it. You can hope that nothing's going to happen. You could pray to God that he doesn't go on one of those social sites and meet somebody on the computer, which takes, what, like Tinder, like 3 seconds? No. You have to be in tune and attuned to the problem and know that, hey, it's been 2 or 3 days. My husband hasn't said much to me. I want to see where he's at, where he's holding. Maybe I need to spend more time with him. Oh my God, you know, I'm 50. I don't like it the same as I did when I was 25. But you know what? Maybe he does. So I have to think about that. These are things that we have to talk about because to ignore it means then we can become another statistic, God forbid.